So we are very happy to have Yordan Zaykov here today. Yordan Zaykov has for many years been working with John Wynn and Tom Minka at Microsoft Research on the InferNET project, where he's one of the lead developers. I believe that Yordan has an announcement for us today.
I'll do it. Let me do it.
All right.
All right, I'll just go. Hey, everyone. I'm Yordan.
One more thing. Sure. So at the end of Yordan's talk, we'll actually have John Wynn and Tom Minka Skype in to take questions. Now, if you would like to ask a question to one of these developers, please come down to the front and speak into the microphone so that, given that they're on Skype, they can actually hear you speak.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the introduction. My name is Yordan. I'm leading the probabilistic inference development team at Microsoft Research in Cambridge. That's the original Cambridge, by the way, in the UK. and I hope we also already have Tom Minka and John Wynn join the call. They are the primary architects of infer.net, and you probably also know them as the inventors of expectation propagation and variational message passing. So just a few words about the framework. So Tom and John started working on it in 2004. And then we had a development team, and we did the first release in 2008. Ever since, the framework has been used in a lot of research publications. Even in 2013, we got the Patents for Humanity Award from the US Patent Office for aiding research in healthcare. And for all of these years, we've been using it in Microsoft in many products, which is what I'm going to talk about today. But it hasn't been really used outside Microsoft commercially because it had a very restrictive license for academic use. But that is about to change, so I'm extremely excited and honored to announce here at the first probabilistic programming conference that effective immediately, infer.net is open source. Yay, thank you. Yeah, and you can all go to the website, you can clone it, you can play with it, and we'll be extremely happy if you contribute. It has now a very permissive MIT license, just because we're now in MIT, no other reason for that. And we also released it under the .NET Foundation, which is a non-profit organization. Some work that will probably be appreciated by this community that we did in the last few months is to make it run on .NET Core. That's an initiative by Microsoft where we have a runtime and an SDK that runs equally well on Windows, Linux, and macOS. Hopefully all of that is great, and you guys will just jump in and take a look. So here's an architecture diagram of what the system looks like. So as I said, we run on top of the .NET Core runtime. And on top of that is the infer.NET runtime, which has a large set of distributions. And it runs something that I would call deterministic approximate Bayesian inference, which is probably the main difference between infer.NET and all of the other probabilistic programming frameworks that you're going to hear about in the next couple of days. So we do message passing typically in factor graphs, and we have a large base of factors which specify exactly how messages should be passed around. There's no black box inference, there's no ADVIs, nothing that requires sampling, right? So you have the factors that tell you what projections should be done and how the distribution should be computed for the specific VI algorithm. On top of that is the infer.NET compiler, and on top you've got all of the applications. I'll talk about a few applications here. It's worth mentioning that the applications can use the compiler to generate the inference algorithm and then in production code straight into this generated algorithm so that they avoid compilation for improved performance. I'll talk about, we picked four different models that we've productized, and I like these applications not just because I got a promotion for shipping each one of them, but because they demonstrate that probabilistic programming can go beyond its typical use in the industry, which is just, I'd say, data analysis. People tend to just fit some data to a model, and they look at the model, you know, they make certain business decisions based on that, and that's great. But I think we take things to the next level where the probabilistic programs actually become a part of consumer or business products. Right, so just a few words about each one of these. The first one is a personalized email classifier which shipped in our email server. It's called Exchange, it's a part of Office. And they had the problem that in corporations, people tend to receive a lot of emails. And they don't really look at many of them, and we wanted to figure out, based on their past behavior, like what emails they replied to, what emails they've deleted, what they have ignored, and what they have read. So that we can basically say, oh, this email is clutter, you should probably take a look at it later, not immediately. It's implemented as a hierarchical Bayesian classifier, so we have in the first stage is a community training stage where we look at a large number of historical email data, and we learn all parameters of the model. Then these posteriors are fed into the user models as the priors, and then as new data arrives, as the users receive new email messages, the parameters get smoothly and gradually updated through Bayesian inference. So this shipped in 2014, and by late 2015, it had tens of millions of users operating on hundreds of millions of emails. All right, next is Truskill. So I don't know if you know, but modern online multiplayer games use skill-based matchmaking in order to match players into fair and balanced and enjoyable games, okay? So what happens is that players queue up, and then the system decides, oh, you guys should join this team, and you should join this team, and you should play together so that the match is balanced. So in order to do this efficiently, you have to be able to figure out what the skills of the players are very, very quickly. Actually, that's very important for the gaming studios. If a few players join your title and they get destroyed in the first two matches or three matches, they just leave the title, okay? So we have a statistical model over the performance of a player in a match, so we model the game, and we don't just look at the outcome of the match and the participants, but also throw in a lot more data there in the model, like what's the player experience, like what's their learning curve over time, certain performance statistics like kills and deaths and stuff like that. And also we learn correlations between different game modes. So all of this heterogeneous data is thrown into one model. And yet again, we've got an offline phase where we do batch inference over a large number of matches. And we learn basically all of the parameters of the model are learned. There's no hyperparameter tuning or anything like that. And then at runtime, basically as people play, we update their skills using online inference, which happens in like less than a millisecond per match. This is currently running live in Halo and Gears of War. These are pretty large titles. They have hundreds of millions of matches. And I hope that soon it will be running in many more games. Okay, so the next is Matchbox. This is a general purpose recommender system which combines collaborative filtering and content-based filtering into one coherent model. So in collaborative filtering is like when some user likes some item or rates some item, and then separately you have stuff like user features, like age and gender and so on, and item features, like in the case of a movie, that would be like a year of release or a genre. So all of this, again, heterogeneous data is in one model, initially shipped in Xbox Live, again, offline and an online phase. It was used to recommend movies and games to Xbox Live users. And right now it's running in production in Azure Machine Learning, which is our cloud-based platform for machine learning, where you can hook up different machine learning blocks, and then by a click of a button, they get deployed as a web service. So I don't have any usage statistic for that because the web service is running in the user's environments, to which we obviously don't have access. And finally, I'm a little nervous to talk about this because we haven't published it yet. It's a system called Alexandria, which tries to go online, look at the internet. Conveniently, we're one of the companies that have a copy of the internet cached in our backyard, and extract all of the knowledge from the internet in a structured form. Okay, in order to achieve this, it performs inference over strings. So it has a generative model for converting knowledge-based facts into unstructured text. And it achieves very high precision and coverage because the uncertainty in the text is propagated through the probabilistic program to the extracted facts. And it can go online, it can discover facts, it can discover entities, and can also discover the properties of these entities, so the schema. That all of that is learned. It runs in a truly internet scale, depending on how you define that, but in our case, that's petabytes of data and billions of web pages. All right, so what are the features that Infer.net has that basically enabled all of this? The first one is that we are good at doing online learning. when you go in production, you quickly realize that your products deal with user data, and user data keeps on arriving, usually in large volumes, and you really want to be able to learn from this. And that's very important. And so what really matters is how quickly you can get from data to results, okay? So in our case, the model basically gives the formula for doing that. So we don't do any sampling. We just run to, we do a fixed point iteration, and in infer.net, the prior and the posterior have the same functional form. So you don't need to convert from one to the other, which would basically probably kill performance. So next comes up performance and scalability. So we do efficient inference, and I'm sure that anyone here will say, oh, we do efficient inference. I hope that this is demonstrated in the scale of the products that we shipped. Really, I don't have any other like comparisons with other tools, but you'll just have to take my word for it, I guess. And the volume of the data that the shipped products operate on. So Infer.net is a we have a compiler. What this means is that so the compiler just takes the model and emits an inference algorithm. So the data structure that's used to represent the model is not carried over in production, meaning that you directly call into the inference code. Okay, so you can avoid entirely the compilation in production modes. And finally, something that we also worked on in the last couple of years is to make models distribute over a cluster. So for example, in the case of, in TrueScale, we have something like, I don't know what is these days, 50, 60 machines that communicate via MPI in a RDMA-supported environment, which is really cool. Something else that's important in production is like when deadlines approach and products need to ship, it's important how quickly you can explore different models. So in infer.net, inference is entirely automatic. So you write your program, you hit compile and run, and it compiles and runs. Okay, so there are no intermediate steps. Like you don't have to specify your own schedule, which you have to in other languages. And that's a pretty important one, I think, because for a large model, you can probably specify a schedule as a human, but it won't be optimal. Like you really need a machine to create an optimal schedule for you. And Tom Mink actually had to invent some theorems to make our scheduler work well. One more thing is like it's important to be able to compare models, see which model performs better. That's done in 3 or 4 lines of code, depending on how you write the curly braces, just by computing model model evidence. And finally, we have, I think, very rich modeling blocks. So we have obviously continuous and discrete variables. These mix very well. So you can write something like a Gaussian mixture. How should I put it? Writing a Gaussian mixture is not awkward. Let me put it this way. We have distributions over strings, over sparse lists. As I said, the distribution over strings is a finite state machine, is an automaton. And I think like you have strings in your normal programming language. I think you should have strings in your probabilistic programming language. And we're also adding date, time, and dictionary now through Alexandria again. You know, in Python, dictionary is a native type. You'd expect to have that in your probabilistic programming language too, right? We also have plates, which are probabilistic for loops, power plates, which allow you to raise a part of the model to a power, stochastic gates. I would recommend reading the gates paper by Tom Mink and John Wynn. That's the true if statement. And we also support jagged arrays. These are arrays of variable lengths. Okay, just want to show you what a Hello Uncertain World program looks like. So here we have two uniform distributions over strings. We concatenate them with a space in the middle, and we say the result should be Hello Uncertain World. So now if you infer the posterior over these two strings, these two strings, what do you think that is? Like the posterior over string one. Go on. That's exactly right, yeah. So 50% on hello and 50% on hello uncertain. And therefore, the posterior over string 2 will be 50% over uncertain world and 50% over world, which is something that I think we as a community should be able to write. Okay, let me just finish up with one more announcement. So we have a free online book that you can all go and take a peek at. It's at mbmlbook.com. This stands for Model-Based Machine Learning. It provides a very gentle introduction to the whole paradigm. So I think if you're just a software engineer, that's a very good starting point to take a look. It will teach you all of the basics of statistics with very nice examples and pictures. All right, so thank you very much. That's everything from me. And so, I don't know if we have Tom and John on the call.
Yes.
We do.
That's right.
Awesome.
I don't know if we do.
So I'm here.
Oh, great.
Can you hear us?
Yes.
Yes, we can.
Okay, so if anyone has any questions, please come down here to the mic.
Or ask and we'll repeat it.
Or ask it and we'll repeat that.
So John, you're literally here as a giant head in the sky.
Oh, wow. Hi, everyone.
And also, Tom over there is a smaller head.
I need to shrink my head.
Could you ask John to tell us more about the Alexandria model?
John, you're asked to tell people more about the Alexandria model.
Well, Yordan did a great summary of it. I guess the idea is that we have a strongly typed knowledge base, we want to model the process of people talking about the knowledge in that knowledge base. So we're not talking about just sort of lexical representations, but where, you know, dates are real probabilistic dates and objects are real probabilistic objects. So there's full uncertainty over all of the knowledge in the knowledge base. And then we have the probabilistic program that expresses the relationship between that knowledge and the text that you might see on the web, and then essentially make use of InferNet to invert that process, right up to the point of being able to reason about types. Yordan mentioned that we learned schema, so we actually be able to run inference over type objects themselves, which is really, I think, very exciting to be able to do that. So by which I mean not just necessarily which of a set of types an object is, but actually the definition of the type itself. So we actually do probabilistic reasoning about type definitions, which I think is really exciting.
Great. One more question, maybe?
Yeah, can we query that knowledge graph? Is there an API? Because we asked it yesterday that that's the, you know, why do we have it? You know, can we query?
The question is whether you can query the knowledge graph, John, if there's an API to it.
It's not public at this point. It will be folded into Microsoft's knowledge graph. So there are various sort of ways of accessing that right now.
Okay, maybe one more question for Tom, or you guys know everything. Yeah, go on. Okay. The question is if we've done any work in program synthesis. Either Tom or John. Tom, we can't hear you, by the way.
I guess I would want some clarification of what you mean by program synthesis. Do you mean text? Because that would be sort of like the Alexandria type of thing.
Searching in the space of programs.
Well, if you basically create a model with uncertain elements to it, like gates, then that's essentially what you're doing when you're on inference.
So I guess one way of looking at that is a constrained search amongst programs rather than perhaps a more free-form one.
Well, maybe the question is about searching in the space of probabilistic programs, in which case it's more about nested inference, like can you do inference about inference? Maybe that's what they're asking. And that's not supported in InferNet. But if you're asking can we reason about a program, meaning where this program come from, then yeah, just the same way that Alexandria can.
All right, let's thank Yordan, the speaker, and let's also thank John and Tom for Skyping in. And finally, thank you guys for open sourcing infer.net. I think this is very exciting, and I hope that we'll see a lot of use of infer.net in the probabilistic programming community.
Awesome.